गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे वी विल डिस्कस मैसेज ऑथेंटिकेशन कोड. सो देयर आर इन ऑर्डर टू प्रोवाइड द ऑथेंटिकेशन सो वी कैन यूज हैश फंक्शंस message authentication code as well as the digital signatures. In today's class we'll see what is message authentication code. Before that, all of you answer this four question. Is all only one student responded. Is all of you give your answer? I'm going to end the poll. Only three students. So the question is secure hash algorithm 3 uses different types of step functions in the iteration function. So one of the step functions is theta step function. So all step functions uses either substitution or permutation methods. Among them, theta step function uses the substitution. Is it true or false? It is true. So coming to the topic, generally, in order to provide the authentication, so which is the security service, authentication is one of the security service. Authentication is one of the security service. In order to provide the security service, we can apply message encryption. Means we can encrypt the message. That is one procedure. Second one is we can apply the hash function. And the third procedure is the we can apply the message authentication code can be applied. So we know what is message encryption and what is a hash function. How can we apply the hash function? Now we'll see MAC. Message authentication code. So what is this message authentication code means? In order to provide the authentication, that is once the receiver is receiving the message, so receiver has to come to the conclusion that it is from a specified source, specified sender itself. For that, so first the sender will send a message to the receiver. So what message is going to be sent by the sender is, sender will take the message M, and then sender will apply some message authentication code. So we'll apply some function. We'll apply some function over the message. The inputs for the function is message as well as the key. So sender will use some key, secret key. So both the sender and receiver will use the secret key. This function will take message as well as the key. So it generates some code. So that the code is called as the message authentication code. So here this code is also called as the cryptographic checksum. So once the code is generated, MAC code is generated, then the sender will append that code to the message. So message will be concatenated with the message authentication code. So that will be transmitted to the receiver. So that is a general procedure. So once the receiver is going to get the message as well as the MAC code, so how the receiver will come to know that it is from the so-and-so person is, so receiver will take the message and then again receiver will apply the function, same function, that is the, in order to compute the MAC, it applies the function and then input will be message as well as the key. So here it produces the code or the checksum, and also the receiver received the checksum, right? I mean MAC code. So if these two are equal, then authentication will be verified. So that is the procedure. So in order to generate this MAC code, we'll use different types of algorithms. So we'll see the algorithms. So before going to discuss the algorithm, first we'll see the requirements for message authentication. So what are the requirements for message authentication? Why receiver has to authenticate? I mean, sender is going to send. Here sender is sending the, along with the message. So it is going to send the MAC code. So this MAC code is called as the authenticator. The code which is attached to the message is called as the authenticator. So why this authenticator is required is because of these attacks. So there will be different types of active and passive attacks, right? So if there is any disclosure of the message, so once the sender is sending the message and if the message is going to be disclosed, then the receiver might not get the opponent will get the message. So before going to the message is going to be received by the receiver, opponent will get the message and the opponent will able to get the key. So this is one of the attack and traffic analysis. So what, so already we discussed these all attacks. So what the opponent is going to do is opponent will observe the frequency, how frequently it is going to be communicated and how many messages are transmitted between the sender and receiver and what will be the length of the message. So all these things will be observed. So for this, once the opponent is going to perform all these things, opponent will try to include some data and will send with the sender's identity. So this is also one of the requirements for the message authentication. So if the authentication is provided, then even though the opponent is observing, there is no use because opponent will not able to send a message. So here, authenticator, sender is going to send, along with the identity, sender is going to send the authenticator. If opponent is trying to have the identity of the sender, still opponent will not get the authentication, authenticator will not produce the authenticator. So that is why this message authentication code should be attached to the message. Along with the message, this MAC code or the hash function should be attached. So traffic analysis means in connection oriented, it may be the frequency. So frequency of the messages, how frequently they are going to transmit the messages and what is the duration of the connection. If it is ongoing communication, what is the duration? And in connectionless environment, it is going to check the opponent will observe the length of the messages. And based on that, we'll try to determine what is the actual message. So masquerade attack is there. So our attacker will take the sender's identity. So So here attacker itself will generate some messages, will send with the sender's identity. So that is the masquerade attack. And sometimes opponent will change the content, will modify, like at an opponent can insert or can delete, can reorder the messages and all. So that is one of the requests. So sequence modification, yes, reordering will be takes place in the sequence modification. So timing modification, so there will be suppose if the sender is going to send a message at timestamp t1 and authenticate, the opponent will change the timestamp so that there will be a delay in messages, so that will affect the ongoing communication. And a repetition, in this there is no opponent, instead sender or receiver will claim that even though they received the message, they can claim that message was not received or message was not sent, like that repetition will be done. So in order to prevent all these things, different types of authentication techniques should be used, like message authentication code, hash functions and all. So already we discussed what is a hash function. Now we'll see. So message authentication is a procedure to verify that the received messages come from the source without any alteration. And also it verifies the sequencing and the timeliness. So the time ordering of the messages will be done. So along with the message authentication, so digital signature, so here hash functions is one of the message authentication technique, and MAC code is also, generating the MAC code is also message authentication technique, and encryption, message encryption is also one of the technique, and digital signature is authentication technique. So what the digital signature means, source will have source will take a block of plain text and it will apply the sign over the, by using the block of text, and that will be attached to the original message. That is a digital signature. So once the digital signature is added to the message, obviously authentication will be provided. So message authentication functions. So here, so in order to provide the message authentication, so one can use the hash functions or the message authentication code. So here how it is going to be generated is, first it will apply some algorithm or the function, it applies some function. So that function will generate some fixed length code. So fixed length code will be generated. So that fixed length code is called as the authenticator. Authenticator is nothing but generating the fixed length code using the hash function or using the MAC. So either of the things. Next, so once it is done, then what it will be done. So generating the authenticator will be done at the source side. And what the receiver is going to do is, receiver will verify the authenticity of the message. Means, again, receiver will compute the, for a given message and with the given hash function. So whichever the hash function is applied over the sender, or whichever the MAC function is applied over the sender, the same function will be applied and it will be compared. The received MAC code will be compared with the computed MAC code. If then in that manner, it can apply the, it can verify the authentication of the sender. So as I said, there will be three techniques. So in order to provide the message authentication, so first step is the message encryption. So entire data will be converted to the ciphertext, plain text will be converted to the ciphertext. So itself will considered as an authenticator. There is no special authenticator will be added. So whatever ciphertext is generated, that will be generated based on the secret key which is shared between the sender and receiver. So that itself will be act as an authenticator. But it will not be sufficient, because once the receiver is trying to take a brute force attack on some of the algorithms, or if the receiver is able to attack using some chosen ciphertext or some other types of attacks, then it will be failed. right? And what the receiver is going to do is simply receiver will alter the message and will apply. So that is one of the techniques. Second one is the message authentication mode. So it is a public function of the message. So here message authentication code generates the fixed length like hash function. But the difference is hash function will not use any key. Simply it will take a message, hash function, message will be given to the hash function and then it generates some hash code, fixed length hash code. The small h is the fixed length hash code. So this hash function may be any of the algorithms like SHA-1 algorithm, SHA-512, SHA-3, SHA-2. So different, any type of secure hash algorithm will be applied. Whereas in the message authentication code, it makes use of a key. So key will be used. So what the message, given a message, it applies some function. Okay. So which takes input as message as well as the key. So which is shared between the sender and receiver. Then it produces the code. So that is the MAC code. So whereas in hash functions, only message is the input. Message is the only input to the hash function. So that is the difference. So where hash function is a fixed length, it produces the fixed length code as well as MAC message authentication code will also produce the fixed length. Output is fixed length code will be produced, but the procedure will be different. See, so it is going to produce a fixed length code, whereas hash function is also producing the fixed length hash value or hash code or message digest. So that will be as an authenticator. In message encryption, ciphertext will be considered as the authenticator, whereas in message authentication code, the generated fixed length code will be considered as an authenticator. In hash functions, again, whatever the generated fixed length hash value is there, that will be considered as an authenticator. So message encryption. So using the message encryption, so it can already we know. So how a message encryption will be performed using the symmetric as well as the public key encryption. So in symmetric, both sender and receiver have the same key. Okay. And in public key encryption, so sender and receiver will have two different keys. I mean, public key will be there, private key will be there with the source as well as a destination. So if sender is encrypting the message, using the public receiver, using receiver's public key, then at decryption side, at receiver side, receiver has to decrypt the message using the private key of the receiver, private receiver. Or if the sender is encrypting the message using the sender's private key, then receiver has to decrypt the message using the sender's public key. So whichever the key is used at sender side, the same person's key should be used, but it should be a private or the public key. So that we know. So message encryption. So this is the symmetric message encryption, the pictorial representation, and this is for the public key encryption. So whenever this is applied, it provides authentication as well as the confidentiality, which is another security service. So how it is going to provide this confidentiality means once the data is encrypted, if the encrypted data is transmitted over the network, obviously confidentiality will be provided. So here in symmetric encryption, obviously confidentiality will be provided because encrypted data is transmitted over the network. Again, here also symmetric, public key encryption, encrypted data is transmitted. So how the data is encrypted is using receiver's public key. So at the receiver side, it is using the receiver's private key. And how it is going to provide the authentication is here in public key cryptography. So in order to provide the authentication, the sender has to encrypt the message using sender's private key instead of receiver's public key. Sender has to encrypt the message using sender's private key, and at decryption side, receiver has to use the receiver's sender's public key. So in that manner, authentication will be provided. So in order to provide, so once the data is transmitted, I mean, encrypted using the sender's private key, it will not provide the confidentiality, because anyone can decrypt. So once the encrypted using sender's private key, anyone can decrypt, because not only the receiver, anyone can decrypt, because the public key is the sender's public key is available to anyone. So that is why here it is not providing the confidentiality. So in order to provide the confidentiality, it is using both sender's private and public keys and receiver's private and public keys. So first it is encrypting the data using the sender's private key, and then so again it is going to encrypt the data using receiver's public key. So at the receiver side, it is using the receiver's private key as well as the sender's public key. So here all these things will be provided. So once the private key is used at the sender side, then it is going to provide the, it ensures the authentication as well as the signature. If private key is used at the sender side, it ensures both authentication and signature. If it uses private key as well as the public key, then it ensures the confidentiality, authentication and the digital signature. So coming to the message authentication code, so as I said, so it generates a small fixed size block. Given a message, it generates a fixed size block by applying some function, and that output is called as the cryptographic checksum or the MAC code. So how, so this will be appended to the message and that will be transmitted, the appended, this entire thing will be transmitted over the network. So sender will generate this and send, so when it is going to be transmitted, so which data will be transmitted is this entire thing will be transmitted, message along with the message authentication code. So in order to generate, it uses a function. So that function is called as the MAC function. So before that, both the sender and receiver will share the key. So this K is the secret key which is shared between sender and receiver. So what the receiver is going to do, once the sender is going to send the message, receiver will compute the MAC again, and it compares the received MAC, compares with the received MAC. So here the basic uses of the authentication. So how it is, so it can use, I mean, it can, in order to provide the authentication, so first step is it can simply apply the MAC function. So this is, C is the MAC function, it generates the MAC code. So this MAC code can be concatenated with the message that will be transmitted over the network. And then at the receiver side, so receiver will take the received MAC code and they will compute the MAC code again with the given message and compares. And here it is not providing any confidentiality. In first case, it is not providing the confidentiality, because the data is transmitted over the network, only directly the message has been transmitted, not the encrypted format. So if the message is directly transmitted over an insecure channel, so confidentiality will not be provided. So only message authentication is provided. So in order to provide the confidentiality, so in second case, what it is going to do is, simply, so after concatenation message, so here output of this concatenation message concatenated with MAC code. So this entire thing will be encrypted. So here it is encrypting data. This entire thing will be encrypted using the another key. So there will be two keys. One key is used for generating the MAC code. Second key is used for encrypting the message. So encrypted data will be transmitted over the network, means it is going to provide the confidentiality, and authentication will be provided because MAC is appended to the message and it is tied to plain text. So how can we say that it is tied to plain text is, MAC is generated, MAC code is generated using the message, using the plain text message to be directly given to the MAC function. So it is plain text. Suppose if you observe the third scenario, message is encrypted. First message is encrypted using some key. So that is symmetric key algorithm, because the same key is used for the decryption. And then MAC function is applied. Message authentication code function will be applied using the K1. Here, so what is happening is encrypted data only transmitted over the networks. So that is why confidentiality will be provided. So authentication will be provided. Why? Because it is going to append the MAC code. And also here it is tied to ciphertext. Means message authentication function, or the C is applied to which one? C is not taking the input. The input of C is, input to C is ciphertext. Okay, so encrypted. Suppose ciphertext is M dash. So M dash and the key is K1. It is going to use K1. So in second case, so for message authentication code function, the input is M and K1. Whereas in second case, it is applying the function using the M dash, that is a ciphertext. So that is, we call it as a authentication is tied to ciphertext. So these are the basic uses of the MAC. And the requirements for the MAC authentication code. So why we have to apply the MAC authentication code. So first of all, MAC is a many-to-one function. So even though the MAC is attached to the message, so while it is transmitted over the network, the opponent should not get the message, or should not be the authenticator. So once the authenticator is, authenticator in a sense, MAC code. So if the opponent will get the MAC code, again, so what the opponent will do is, will alter the message. Opponent will alter the message. Opponent will include that authenticator, and then it will be transmitted over the network. So it will be transmitted over the network. So that is why, so if an opponent knows the MAC function, opponent knows, so which MAC function was used. Now obviously all MAC functions are the public, right? All algorithms are public. So MAC function, so opponent knows the MAC function, but doesn't know which key is used in order to generate the code. Then, so the thing is, the requirements, so that opponent should not get the MAC code. So the requirements are, so opponent can observe the message as well as the MAC code. So once the opponent is having the MAC code, opponent should not get the message. Opponent should not get the message. Means MAC is a length code, right? MAC is a fixed length code. For a given message, one can generate the MAC code using the key. Once the MAC code is generated, using the MAC code, opponent should not get the message. Means what the opponent is going to do is, opponent will take another message, M dash. So the original message is M, and the opponent will consider the message M dash and will apply the same function, whatever is applied at the sender side. And then you use some key. Then so both opponent will not get the same code. So for another message, even though the same key is used, but for two different messages, so it is computationally infeasible to generate the same MAC code. Same MAC code will not be generated. So even though the opponent has the MAC code, because MAC code will be turned over the insecure channel, right? It is, opponent will not be able to construct the message, that is M dash will not be constructed where M dash and M are same. So means opponent will not generate the original message using the MAC code. Okay, and second requirement is MAC code will be created using the key, that is K. And then, So if the message is M, and there will be so if the opponent is trying to get the so from a given MAC code, if the opponent is trying to get the message, so M dash, so that message M dash will not be equal to M. So there will be the probability. So where M dash is equal to M, the probability is only 2 power minus N, where N is the number of bits in the tag. What is this tag? Tag is nothing but the MAC code. So what the opponent is trying to do is, opponent will apply the brute force attack. Opponent will try all the possibilities based on the chosen plain text. So opponent will think that this might be the message. So based on that message only, the MAC code is generated. So we'll think in our manner, and then we'll apply the brute force attack, but the probability is very less. And the third requirement is, so if the opponent is trying to construct the message, that is M dash, so that is equal to some known transformation on M. So M is the original message. So what the opponent is trying to do is, so opponent will construct the message, so by applying some function. Okay, by applying some function. So here the thing is, opponent will have the MAC code. Okay, opponent will have the MAC code and will try to produce the message. So here opponent will have the pair of MAC codes, message and MAC codes will be available, right? So by using the available MAC codes, so we'll try to generate the message. So if that matches, opponent will think that this might be the authenticator. So these are the requirements, the three requirements of the codes. So here, HMAC is one of the algorithms. So MAC generates the fixed length code, right? So here, HMAC algorithm. So HMAC is one of the message authentication code algorithms. HMAC is nothing but, it includes both hash functions as well as the message authentication code procedure. Both hash function will not take any secret key. Message authentication will take the key. We'll see how it is going to be generate the MAC code. From the HMAC algorithm. So first it takes the hash function, embedded hash function. So it can take any of the hash functions. So we discussed SHA-1 algorithm, right? So it can take SHA-512 or SHA-3, MD5. So these are all the algorithms. So first it takes the hash function, and then along with the hash function, it uses different inputs. So it uses one initial value. So anyway, so hash functions will use the initial value, right? Hash functions will take two inputs. So we know the base structure of the hash function. It will take two inputs. One is the plaintext block. Plaintext block, blockwise data will be divided into the blocks, and the initial value will be given. And if the initial value size is n bits, it produces the n bits, irrespective of the size of the plain text. So suppose plain text block is B bits, size is B bits, but output of the hash will be bits. So it will be applied the same compression algorithm repeated number of times based on the algorithm. Finally, the last step, whatever the output is produced, n bit output is produced, that will be considered as the hash code, right? Or the message digest or hash value. So that because this HMAC is going to use the hash function, so initialization vector should be used. And then message input to the HMAC. So entire plain text will be divided into the blocks. So that message should be applied. And then, so YI is nothing but the ith block. So every block will have the size of some B bits. And the total number of blocks will be L number of blocks. These L number of blocks will be there. And B is the size of each block, the number of bits in each block. So So n is nothing but length of the hash code produced by the embedded hash function. So finally, it is going to produce the n-bit hash code. We'll see in the block diagram, and it uses the secret key. So this is the extra step in the MAC functions, whereas in hash functions there is no secret key. Okay, so there is no secret key, but here it uses the secret key. So there will it, secret key will be of some size, some length will it may or may not be equal to the plain text size, but if size is less than the plain text, it is going to add some bits. So k plus is nothing but for a given key, so it is going to add some bits. So it pads with zeros on the left so that the result of bits. So if the size of the k is less than the message block size, then it is going to add the zeros at the left of the key. Then the length of the key will be equal to the block size. So that equal length key is called as the represented with the k plus. So this is the structure of the HMAC. So what the block diagram, we can say it as a block diagram. So this is the message. YL minus 1 is the message, and what it is going to do is it is going to append some data. So first it is going to append yes. So it is going to append yes. So where the size of s is some i number of bits. Okay, so or it is going to add some s bits. Some bits will be added to the message. So this entire thing, so how the bits will be added, so which type of bits will be added means, so though it is a binary representation, so whatever the added data is there, that yes is the added data to the message, right? So how this data will be added is simply it is going to take the key will be considered, and then it is going to add. So key, k plus is nothing much. It is going to the size of k plus, and the length of the k plus is equals to the length of the plain text message block. So k plus mod k plus is equals to mod y zero. Then it is going to take XOR operation. So this is the XOR operation with the what iPad. So what is this iPad means? It is some bits. iPad is nothing but if you observe, so iPad is 00110110. So 00110110 is the iPad. So what it is going to do is simply this is some hexadecimal representation of 36, and it will be repeated d by 8 times. So because both will be added, so both will be added. XORed. K plus as well as the iPad will be XOR, so that iPad value is only 36, that is here it is having the 8 bit representation, but depending on the key size it will be repeated by b by 8 times, remaining all will be zeros. So once it is added, this s bit is added to this, then it applies the hash function. First step is it is going to add the s bits. Then it is applying the hash function. So it may be any algorithm like SHA-1 algorithm. So in order to apply this algorithm, it requires the initial value. So the length of the initial value is n bits, and it produces the hash code. So this is the hash code. And then once it is going to generate the hash code, again, it is going to apply the same thing. So it is going to apply the hash function again over the output. So how it is going to apply is again, so k plus will be used here. It second time it is going to use the opad. So opad is nothing but the number of bits again. So 8 bits will be there, where the representation value of that 8 bits is 5c. So it will be XORed with the k plus value, and then the bits will be added. Yes, bits will be added. So this time again, whatever the output is generating. So here the output is B bits. B bits will be generated. That will be added to the message, not the plain text here. Instead, it is the hash code. so we can represent this as some small h. So hash code will be generated. So that hash code will be a fixed size, but it will consider it as, it will be converting that to b bits, so plain text block size bits. And then again it applies the hash function. So here again it may apply any type of the hash function, and along by using the initialization vector. Finally, whatever the code is generated, so that is the HMAC code, that is the fixed length code, that will be appended to the message if you observe the formula. So HMAC of the key and the plain text is, first it is going to take the K plus, this is K plus, will be XORed with the OPAD, and then it applies the hash function. So it applies the hash function, and then it applies a hash function with the IPAD, and then that will be concatenated with the message. So that is the output of the HMAC algorithm. But here it has some drawback. So this is a step by step procedure. You can go through this step by step procedure. But there is some drawback in the basic version of the HMAC, because always it is going to take the initialization vector. So directly the initialization vector is given to the hash function. You observe. So initialization vector is directly given to the hash function. So in order to overcome that, so initialization vector will be given to a function. So where this function will take two inputs. So one is the initialization vector, and then it takes the result of this K plus XORed with the IPAD. So this result will be considered, will be given to one function. The output of that function will be n bits. So internally it can perform some bitwise operations, logical operations, and that will be given to the hash function. So here it generates the code. So that code will be resized to the B bits, because the code is generating the n bits. So this n is less than or is equals to B bits. So this n will be converted to the B bits. In order to convert, it is going to add some zeros on the left side of the message. And then again, the same thing. So here it will apply, it will XOR, the K plus will be XOR with the OPAD, and it generates the message. I mean, S bits will be generated. Again, initialization value will be given to the function. So this time initialization value, the function will input values, input will be initialization vector K plus with OPAD. So this is the function. It takes the values and it applies some binary logical operations over the binary data, and it produces the n bit data. And then it will be given to the function, hash function, and it produces the n bits output. So this will be the final output of the HMAC algorithm. Okay, so coming to the security of the HMAC. So the security of the MAC function is based on the embedded hash function, because it is going to, the entire plain text will be given. So if you observe, the entire plain text will be given to the hash function itself. See, so hash function is going to take two inputs. One is the input, and the second one is, so in previous, in the basic version, hash function is going to take the input. So S bits are added to the message itself. S bits are added to the message, and directly it is going to take the initialization vector. In the revised version, it is going to take, hash function is taking the message, and then initialization value will be S bits will be given to the function. S bits as well as the initialization value will be given to the function, that generates n bit output, that will be given to the hash function. So the main idea is hash function will be used in order to generate the message authentication code. So here the attacker can compute an output of the compression function even with an initialization value that is random, secret, and unknown to the attacker. So here directly it is not going to take the initialization value. Instead, it will be given to a function. So attacker can compute the compression function. So this one can compute this compression function. Compression function is f here. Okay, and so if attacker is able to compute the compression function, again this will be a challenge. So attacker finds the collisions in the hash function even when the initialization vector is random and secret. So attacker will find the collisions, means so it is going to generate the same hash code for multiple messages. Okay, so even though we are going to consider the sender is going to consider the different random initialization value, so for a given message attacker will get find the collisions, means it can generate the for two different messages with the given initialization value, it can get the same code or the message authentication code will be generated. This is about the HMAC algorithm and the features and the requirements of the message authentication code. So there are some algorithms in message authentication code. We'll discuss in the next class. Any doubts? If no doubts, you can leave. Thank you.